some fencing yesterday, and we have staff went over some vehicles that we basically go forward with, and I'm gonna have Wayne start off on what they come up with.
Yes, there was three vehicles that were approved by the board when they adopted the budget for replacement. We went to bid for those vehicles. We got a very good response from that bid. Historically, we've had very good response from local automotive dealers, but we got over five bids, and the apparent bidder was AB Ford, for a little over $91,000 for three vehicles. And with that, staff will approve.
Okay, so I'll go ahead and move on board with 681. Yeah, we talked about this in Wayne. It's good to see a local, well, Peterson's there too, but we have maybe Ford Business and these folks are really needed.
Any more discussion?
One question, what do you do with the local?
Training the end, is it?
Right.
Any more questions? Okay, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carry.
Okay, that concludes the finance report.
Item six B, adjudication and water master plan.
So on October 25th, we're going to have our next regular meeting at 10 a.m. by two of the district water master. Two candidates have received working with each of the advisory committee. Our last meeting, long discussion about candidates. Census at that time, so recommend. So that's after both the testing candidates, back all those in the process. Three choices, and then all of the regions consensus.
Recommendation as to who you should support?
At this time, after the meeting, I have your nine recommendations. Three recommendations of the top three, I have the same advisory. All three recommended by the advisory. All three. Representative of public water suppliers said that they could not have that support, Jennifer's for that. Representative of the representative said they could not support the department. Started discussions about the consensus from the department. At that point, they asked for recess, and he came back and asked.
Interview the two.
And all three candidates were qualified.
Are your mics on? We can barely hear you.
No, they're not.
I can hear. Can you guys just test your?
I can hear you speaking in the mic, but not my.
Yeah, no, they should not be there.
And then I'll speak up loud.
Okay.
I have a problem.
I
So the plan is to deliver the same day.
It is, and if we can get consensus that day, then. The two cameras that pick, I think, like you said, people doing the job, a good job. I think the one, I think it's important, distance has something to do with it, I think, to me, it should be looked at. The other thing is, the gentleman, Markman, he has water experience. I mean, he presently has water experience.
Water experience.
Well, she doesn't have it. I'm not saying she can't. Couldn't, you know, catch up on it, but she doesn't. And so, and plus she's out of Modesto.
Lodi.
Lodi, that's even further in. So, I'm just, if it comes down to equal, we're both at 10-10, you know, you gotta look at the next few things. I think who's accessible in getting here. And the other thing is it, can somebody jumpstart with the experience of having a water master, a little bit of water master background? You know, that's all we'll be asking. You know?
But obviously, it's most important on water master.
Yeah, I know. You need somebody in place before the end of the year.
Correct.
Yeah, the
most important thing is that you want.
But if you listen to some of the people that were on, you know, voicing their opinion, overall, both sides, whatever, I mean, it's not like they could live with either one. It wasn't like, you know, a no-way situation. So at least that's went into the next meeting, that's going to be helpful. But you're right, the most important, we need something in place before the end of the show.
And there's something that, you guys said, I will explore in the next meeting, it's possibly a co-counselor. Often, the co-counselors and that's the way to get consensus that we need direction.
Well, then,
March 1st.
March, okay.
I said August, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was wondering.
Yeah, I'm a misspoke.
Okay.
March 1st.
Are they going to one type of unit, basically? Is this, I don't know what the recommendation is.
There are various types of meters. There's a lot of various ones that are already out there installed. They need to meet AWWA standards for their quality, their testing, their accuracy, and those factors, which is a fair water industry standard. And that's really the main requirement of the installed home manufacturer's recommendations, which usually means there's a certain amount of street pipe before and after the meter, as required by the manufacturer, or to have accurate reads. And then they'll need to be installed by an approved or certified installer, whether that in the process of certifying various installers to do that work for those that need to install new ones. And then for those that are existing, they will be providing photographs of the various meters and locations and all that information to the water masters so that they can maintain their records for all the meters associated with whatever party would be called the water supply.
Okay, so that'll be under, is it under ACWA or AWA?
AWWA, American Water Association.
Okay, so somebody might want to send out a memo to all this group. There's a big conference coming up in Anaheim.
Right.
And there's going to be every national supplier of these meters at this conference that we're going to, some of us are going to. And now when they can talk to everybody,
right,
and take names and phone numbers, and then they'll have a better idea.
Right. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I'll make a note of it.
Okay.
There's actually two, I will make an announcement to on the 25th. There's actually two actual, there's AWWA, Calumet,
well, the vendors will both be
there. They'll be in
California.
You know, there's a requirement to have the requirement is to have a calibrated.
Every what?
Pre-use.
Gary, did you have some problems?
Yeah, I've got a couple of things. Micrometer meter was one that a lot of the landowners and farmers wanted to have. So they're pushing, they meet the AWWA standards. As long as we're allowed to use those, we're satisfied with that. They're based out of home. The other thing, Frank, on that comment on selecting an attorney, the landowners could go both ways with a pardon or some letter. It was a permit. That would answer the same thing. That's a problem. It kind of puzzled the advisory board because the advisory board was a judge. So we didn't know why they were doing this.
Who wants to come back to the meeting? Can you come back to the meeting?
Well, we're bringing the attorneys back. So that's.
It was 40,000.
That's a reason for that. They couldn't settle on it.
That'd be another $100,000 that way.
Landowners could have went both ways. Why would the board advise? There's one rep.
Anything else, Rob? Thank you very much.
But you know what? Go back on Ralph Ross thing. It is extremely important to get an attorney in here. You know, I know somebody's going to feel left out when the final decision is made, but you know what? Their concerns will be addressed. They're not going to be able to do anything on the top. There's going to be so many different people watching. I mean, at least we'll get the thing in motion and get going here.
especially where the landowner is from.
That just might be.
So both might as well, these two will go.
Item 6C, water rates committee. I'll just provide an update.
Yeah, go ahead.
The water rates committee met, provided direction to staff. Staff is pursuing direction as directed by the staff. We plan on having a customer meeting in the next 2 or 3 weeks. Our advertised date for the public hearing is October 24th. We're likely going to request that we delay that to November 14th in order to be able to address these concerns and also provide the time to see this. Other than that, that's just all the updates.
Yes, so what will happen is once the staff meets with the different water purveyors in our district, see what the feedback is. And then when we have a public hearing, Rapitellis, who's our advisor, will show the 5-year plan, which they showed the committee, which is very interesting. So are you talking that we're not going to actually have that hearing until we get the first year?
No, we're just 2 weeks. Just one meeting.
So it'll be in November the year?
Yeah, right. Okay. First meeting in November.
I think it's great that the customers have a chance to look at it.
Item 7, new business presentation, salmon smelt resilience strategy. Justin, look.
Hey Justin, did I hear that they're going to have a stamp next year for fishing them? our fishing license that we're going to apply for a stamp?
Yeah?
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
I don't know. I heard something about that. They're going to have the smell to it.
Probably going to be pretty expensive. Let's see. All right. Yeah, I'm going to sit down here today because I'm going to use the mouse. Okay, got it. Let's get going here. This is part 2 of the presentations regarding some of the actions being promoted to address the endangered fish native to the Delta of Sacramento River. Last time we discussed the Delta smelt. That was a lot of fun. And some of the actions being taken by the state to address those guys. Tonight we're going to discuss the salmon and steelhead. So I'll collectively refer to those as salmonids. Okay. Now we're rolling. All right, this is a map of the Sacramento River on your mouse here. We'll start here at Shasta, running all the way down this way to the Delta down here. And most of the actions we'll discuss are going to be right along that Sacramento River. Went out a couple others. Battle Creek, right here. We're going to discuss a little bit about Battle Creek. Also, Feather River, right, goes up to Oroville right here. And then we've got the Sutter bypass and the Yellow bypass as well. So we're going to have those are the areas primarily we'll be focusing on today. Of course, our pumps are down here, Clifton Court, Four Bay, and pumps the water into the Calvin Aqueduct starting down there. And so we know that from last time, a little bit, those pumps are governed to some extent by our friends here. So we talked about the smell last time. We've got the winter run Chinook salmon, spring run Chinook salmon, and the Central Valley steelhead. So the winter run are endangered, the other two are threatened species. These fish are anadromous fish, which means that they're born in freshwater, migrate out to the ocean for a couple of years, and then return back to freshwater to spawn. The National Marine Fisheries Service estimates that they've lost over 1,000 miles of streams And so we're going to focus a lot of these actions on getting some of that back and increasing their migration. So those have been lost to dams or levees and some inadequate fish ladders and fish schools. We'll talk about some of those things too. Okay, just a real quick background. Went over some of these slides last time, so I'm not going to spend a ton of time on it. But the National Marine Fisheries Service, NMFS, develops biological opinions when projects operate where endangered species exist. They did that for the salmon in 2009 and concluded that the operations are likely to jeopardize those fish. So they developed some reasonable prudent alternatives to avoid that jeopardy. So for the salmon, those are mainly the RPAs that they came up with, mostly focused on aiding migration, improving habitat, repopulating historic habitat, ensuring adequate cold water storage and temperature control, and ensuring essential flows. So in response to the biological opinions, the California Natural Resources Agency released resiliency strategies for smolt and salmon. The salmon one was just released this past June, and it relied pretty heavily on a very similar document put out by National Marine Fisheries Service in 2014 called the Salmon Recovery Plan. Of course, the goal is to advance the species in front of the Endangered Species Act. Restrictions are no longer necessary, so that would result in a reduction of time spent complying with the regulatory requirements and removal of restrictions on water management. So the 2009 biological opinion estimated that the water costs associated with these actions could be 7% of the average annual exports, which was 200,000 acre feet at that time. So we've gone up and down a little bit since then. Focusing in on the salmon resiliency strategy now, the goal is to promote actions that will benefit these species. And they've identified actions that promote restoring habitat, improving stream flows, removing migration barriers, and reintroducing species to idle habitat. So pretty much right in line with the RPAs issued by NMFS. So in the resiliency strategy, there's 13 actions. Eight of those list DWR and or the state water contractors as potential funding sources. And the total of those projects is $180 million that they think they can do over the next 10 years. This slide has all of the actions. We're only going to discuss the ones in blue, and it won't take nearly as long as you might think it will. So bear with me though. Any questions right now before we actually start getting into some of the actions? Alright, cool. Let's move on. Let's start with Battle Creek. Alright, this is a map, and I know the one on the left here is a little difficult to see, so I kind of blew it up on the right here, but this is the Sacramento River here in blue. This is specifically for winter run Chinook salmon, and this is taken from the 2014 salmon recovery plan that I mentioned earlier. The blue and red here, that indicates that those waterways are current waterways that they exist in. The black is historic habitat. They're no longer there. So Battle Creek is one of the areas where they don't more. They only exist in the Sacramento River where releases from Shasta keep the water artificially cold. So there's worry that the drought could curtail releases and then impact water temperatures and stress that population even further. And Battle Creek is kept cold year-round by natural springs, so they'd like to reintroduce winter run salmon back to Battle Creek. So some of the actions that they want to take are some removal of some dams to allow those fish to move up into Battle Creek. PG&E has a hydroelectric project that operates along there, and so they are going to work with them to adjust some of their operations and allow some additional flow to pass by their project to also help aid in the migration. And one of the things they're going to do is establish artificially produce a population of winter run salmon, and then take them to Battle Creek and release them and hopefully they'll thrive. They're going to kind of monitor that, and then hopefully they can phase that out once sort of the wild population can commingle. So that's the hope. They feed $34 million over 45 years. We're going to get that accomplished. Might need to be in the fish business.
You know what's going to happen, don't you? The plants are going to take over the natural, and there's going to be an open season for everybody here. They're doing that enough, I think, in Oregon right now. Has something happened?
The plants, like
the... Yeah, got some wind. They say you can catch as many as you want now. Mm-hmm. Big problem up there right now. The biology, if they just stay the hell away from this stuff, things will just happen one day.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. 34 million is 12 population.
It's going to be more than that. Just wait, we're going to get into it.
not just a warm-up.
All right, so we're going to go on to the, skip a few there, and go on to Feather River. Similar map here. This one is particularly here for the steelhead. Sacramento River here. So here's the Feather River coming up this way, and then it turns black. That all used to be where the steelhead could go. They're not up there anymore. Clicked over, now this is the spring run salmon. Same thing though, Feather River is right here. And they go up to the historic habitat. So what they want to do, there's a rock weir there that only allows the fish to pass when flows are substantial. So they're going to get rid of that. There's some agricultural pump infrastructure up there that needs to be removed and replaced with improved infrastructure. So, $25 million over 3 years for those projects. You can see how it's broken down up there. $2 million to remove the rock dam, and $23 million to improve the infrastructure. Okay, moving along. So, all along the Sacramento River, they're going to work to restore some habitat and migratory conditions. They want to, in total, enhance 6,000 acres of floodplain and riparian ecosystems there to provide some additional rearing habitat and migratory areas. They think they're probably going to do this three different ways. They can do it through a request for proposal. They ask private companies to come in and figure out how to do it for them. They could purchase conservation bank floodplain habitat credits. So these are large areas where they're like, this is going to be our conservation area. So rather than having a bunch of tiny conservation areas all around where the projects are going to be, you can just purchase conservation bank credits in this larger area that's a little bit easier to manage, and have credit for that for your projects.
Do you know what, happened with that? When Edison came through and put the power lines up, they had to have conservation credits, but they didn't do the improvements here. They, on our property, they did it wherever else they had that big project, and they ended up just destroying a bunch of the junipers and things. You wouldn't have to fix things in the same area.
Yeah, I thought I found that pretty interesting. And then the other way they could do that is with some levees set back projects. Move the levees back a little bit and allow some additional areas there. So there were no estimates on this other than significant. So we have other estimates of $30 and $40 million. I don't know what significant really means.
How they going to keep the people out of these areas for recreational use? That's the question I have is when the next 5 million people come to California and the 500,000 are up there every all summer long, it's all going to be destroyed anyway unless they keep them out.
Yeah, maybe they'll make some nature trail.
They'll be utilizing that stream.
Yeah.
You know, not keep it healthy. It's a people's problem. I mean, it's going to be continuing to sap. So.
That is that. Moving right along. some improvements in Sutter Bypass. I think we've got a map here. Okay, this is kind of a map that shows the beginning. The Sacramento River. This little shaded light blue area here is the Sutter Bypass. So the Sutter Bypass and the Yellow Bypass are like flood protection areas. So if the Sacramento River is flowing too strongly, they can allow water to overtop some weirs or open some gates to allow that water to flood into those areas and not overflow the banks of Sacramento elsewhere. So zooming in kind of on that, here's the Sutter Bypass here, kind of this orange shaded area, or hashed area, I guess you could say, right there. So there's a couple things that they want to do with Tisdale Weir, which is right here. So this is Sacramento River. So a lot can flow through here, through this area, over into Sutter Bypass. So they got Tisdale Weir and Weir number one, aka Parks Weir. So they want to improve those two weirs to allow excess water to flow into Sutter Bypass. They think this provides opportunity for large scale fish passage. Also floodplain restoration, which is one of the actions that we wanted to do for smelts and maybe some credit towards that as well. And then flood risk reduction improvements, as that's what that bypass is all about, really, is flood risk reduction. So at Tisdale Weir, they want to make some modifications because fish are getting trapped up in the stilling basin, which is just on the other side of the weir, kind of dissipates the energy of the water going over, and the fish are getting caught up in there somehow, so they have to rescue them.
What do you mean, somehow? Maybe nature them, somehow get caught up then?
Yeah, I think it's the hydraulics of the way that that stilling basin works. Not a huge operation, I don't know exactly all the details, but in my head, and this is probably not right, but in my head, I imagine the water going over and churning up, kind of creating a little whirlpool, and the fish are just out there.
That's natural.
It's natural to the extent that, I mean, it's happening naturally, but if that weir wasn't there, then the fish would be getting caught in that way.
It is man-made.
I think it's bigger. What happens if too much water goes to the weir?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, the Sutter Bypass is a huge expanse of land, so I don't think, I think it can accommodate quite a bit of water. So we want to make some improvements to stop having those fish getting trapped there, and also on the other side, which is the weir number one, that they have an inadequate fish ladder there. It's not allowing the fish to progress. Getting the fish ladder to the minute. But $14 to $20 million is their estimate for those two improvements over 5 years. So the next two items are going to be improvements for Yellow Bypass. So going back to the map here, this is Yellow Bypass down here in the light blue. Bottom of the Sutter Bypass. And then here it is again blown up. So the Sutter Bypass was up there, and then this purple hashed area is the Yellow Bypass, starting here at Fremont Weir. And then coming down, we're going to talk about this improvement to Lisbon Weir here as well. Alright, so yeah, this current habitat for all three salmonids. They want to improve adult salmonid passage by adding or modifying some fish ladders at the Fremont Weir, making some changes to the other weir there to allow for unimpeded fish passage. In this area too, there's some agricultural ditches that the fish are finding their way down and then getting lost in the agricultural areas. They can't find their way back to the Sacramento River, so they can block that from happening. There's some earthen road crossings that they want to remove and replace with permanent bridges. Boxcar culverts so that the fish can continually pass through there all the time. So a lot of stuff going on there to benefit adult fish. They think $30 million over 2 years for those fishes. Oh, so here's kind of really fun. This is a fish ladder. When I was reading about this, I really didn't kind of envision what a fish ladder was or how it worked. So this is a pretty, looks like a pretty complex one to me from Japan. What's happening here is on the other side of this is the river that they're trying to get to. So on the other side of this dam. So they'd be swimming upstream this way. They have no way of getting to that water on the other side with this huge structure in place. So they built this fish ladder. So this is looking at kind of a different angle. They're coming up and they'll get in here. And because salmon can jump, they can jump from like little splash pad to splash pad here and work their way all the way up. And then they go through there. And then they're on the other side of this dam here. Come on. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I
have no idea. It's like,
a lot of work.
Yeah, it is a lot of work. And it's like, I feel like if I would get here, I'd go, no, it's easier to go this way. Let's just stay down here, yeah. So I think that one's like pretty complex. This one, imagine the ones on Sacramento River probably like this. Seem like a little bit easier maybe to get up. On the other side of this, where would be where they're trying to go. was on the poles. Now, fish ladder. That was pretty cool. And some more in the Yolo bypass. They want to add an operable gate in Fremont Weir and at two different levels. So dependent on how much water is flowing through there, there's two different opportunities for the fish to make their way across that. So if the flows are lower, there's a lower gate structure where they can pass through. Or if the flows are higher, then they can make it through that as well. So I will be probably able to use both if that's the case. And then in addition to that, they want to increase the duration and frequency of inundation of the Yolo bypass. This was an action that we discussed a little bit for the smelt as well, so this is a twofer, I guess. And they want to enhance 17,000 acres of floodplain habitat through this project. So $60 million to do that over 10 years. Yes. This one is kind of interesting. They want to construct a permanent Georgetown Assumed Non-Physical Barrier. So this is the Sacramento River in green as it comes down here. And then Georgiana Slough is this channel right here that breaks off kind of by Walnut Grove and comes down this way. It comes down into the interior delta. So Frank's Tract was one of the items in the, that they wanted the smelt to live there. They thought that would be good habitat for the smelt. For salmon, that's not the case because they're trying to make it out to sea. So they don't want the salmon coming into the interior delta. They're going to be pulled possibly down south towards the pumps, not be able to get back out to the sea where they want to get. So one of the things they're tasked with trying to do is figure out how to keep them out of this area here while allowing water to flow. So they develop what they're calling a bioacoustic fish fence. They affectionately also call that a fish disco. And what it is, it's a structure that they're putting in the mouth of the river. Emits bubbles and strobe lights. So it's basically this big bubble curtain of light and sound.
Strobe lights?
Yeah.
Strobe lights. They're thinking they're coming to give them a joint.
Yeah, it's the fish disco. Yeah, they've got them out there. They put little bell bottoms on the fish and they're having a good time. Yeah, so
make sure he's here and all the water crew bearers in the audience. We want to know why the water rate's going up.
Yeah.
This is just the beginning.
Yeah, really.
Right?
Yeah.
Just the beginning. So, anyway, the sound and the lights and the bubbles redirect the fish to continue down the Sacramento River and not go towards that. And they've done some studies in 2011, 2012, I think, that they released some fish north of that and saw what they did. And they found that there's a statistically significant number of fish that were diverted away from the Georgian Slough and continued down the Sacramento.
So, yeah. Oh,
yeah. So, $7.6 to $12.8 million over the next 10 years to implement that project on a permanent basis. Lastly, is to restore tidal habitat within the delta. This is kind of hand in hand with Eco Restore and the smelt strategy. You know, Eco Restore is the partner project to the Water Fix. Their goal is 30,000 plus acres restored of habitat. So this is about a third of that. And yeah, they want to improve area for rearing, migration. They think this could be done through a request for proposal similar to some other projects. That's it for today. That's all I've got. So if you guys have any questions, there's a fish trying to make its way up the river.
But you did.
I heard they could jump 2 feet.
They've been doing that for thousands and thousands of years.
Is there an easy way to figure out how much of this funding is coming from the state water providers?
Well,
where the rest of the funding is coming from?
Yeah, so DWR and State Water Contractors were just identified as potential funding sources in these projects that we talked about. Bureau of Reclamation, Department of Fish and Wildlife, they were also named in some of these projects. You know, the one with the PG&E hydroelectric project, hopefully they're funding some of the money to improve their project. But I couldn't find any specifics And this plan was just released in June. So like the smelt one, we kind of had some idea of what they were actually doing. They had made some progress within a year. So there was a little bit more there to think about. This one is kind of conceptual at this time. Some of the projects have had some background stuff done, but you know, it's not, hopefully next year we have an update on this and know exactly what they're doing. But the statewide contractors do have a group called the Delta Compliance Committee that get together with DWR and discuss some of these projects. So we have a voice in the room where we can say, hey, what are you guys doing with this project? How much money is it costing? So I wasn't able to find a rundown of sum total of all these projects and what our percentage maybe would be of those. But hopefully that's some information that will come forward in the future.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yeah.
Where are the units adequate for this work? And then we have some of the jobs that are there.
Yeah, so apparently standards change with regards to fish ladders, and it probably has to do too with flows. So if the fish ladder starts too high out of the water, like if the flows used to be, you know, 6,000 CFS all the time, and now it's half that, maybe that fish ladder was designed for a higher flow. And now that jump, like that fish is trying to make kind of a big jump there. If that's too high, then they won't be able to make it into that first pool and then continue working their way up the ladder. So that would be an example of an inadequate fish ladder. And so they need to really make improvements on that.
Do you know if the fish ladder is OSHA approved?
Yeah, I don't know. I think the Salmon Union is out there like lobbying for fish ladders. Instead of the work
is off. It just cracked me up. I used to be very involved with fishing game in my earlier life, and they don't have a budget. So who decides? That's pure taxpayers' money. The licenses don't cover anything with the fishing game. So how are they named in it to donate money they don't have? You know, I'm telling you, that I was very involved.
Yeah.
And I was almost working for it. So, yeah, they don't have any money. So that is a crock of baloney when that hear things like that,
yeah,
that are named in it to be part of the construction and participate with the financing. Yeah.
No, it's what it really comes down to is, and one of the things that our contractors are putting together is not only are these two plans that you talked about today, in the last couple, there's quite a few others. You know, there's this regulation that have these mitigation measures, this regulation has these mitigation measures. We're trying to get a handle on all these mitigation measures to find out who's responsible for them, what are they going to cost, who's going to pay for it, because they have all of these, you know, hundreds of projects that are all intended to save the fish. Is just not one plan. I mean, it's really misjointed or disjointed, and the effort is to try and corral all these together to figure out how you can have a logical plan for moving forward and not do one thing that we think is good over here and find out it's actually doing bad things over here. So, you know, have a coordinated effort. Quite frankly, just trying to get your arms around that, because they're making new mitigation requirements with all these matters, whether it's the Bay Delta Conservation Plan, Water Quality Control Plan, you know, all these plans have all their other mitigation measures, all of which have the state water contractors providing the majority of the funding to produce mitigation measures, because they're the ones that have a project that operate within the system.
I think we ought to write a letter to the Sinke, the head of our Interior Department, to see if we can put a mosh with some of this.
Good. Any other questions?
Hi, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Item 8A, bills payable. Consideration and possible action for the period of September 16, 2017 to September 30, 2017, and the supplement in the same country.
Yes, okay, and the supplement.
Are there any questions or discussion in the
planning question. Supplement in my office. I'm the bill on the automation services LLC. What is that?
That's the guy that does our SCADA repair. That was to repair the SCADA at the Lowell pump station. That was Paul.
Any more questions? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Approved. Item 8B, Principal Engineers Construction. First, we'll be discussing the Cassidy Construction Change Order Number 4. If you refer in your agenda to page 45 of 83, there's a summary sheet of the five board orders we'll be discussing. First of which is Operation Center Expansion for Cassidy Construction. It will be approved contract amount of $7,972,000. And this period includes a change order amount of $53,880.40 to bring the change order percentage of the contract up to 1.72%. The change order can be found on page 47 of the agenda. And it lists six items, including installation of infrastructure for a second chiller, grounding the beam pockets, additional sound insulation, hardware for the AV closet, weather bays, and miscellaneous fixtures for the lab and ice maker in the lab. Total coming out to $53,880.40 and a time extension of 69 days.
Now, the original change order for this item was $280,000 that was presented to the staff. We were able to remove quite a bit of those items that were down to $53,000, which is certainly reasonable for the time frame that was for the work that was actually necessary. So I just wanted to let you be aware of that.
The Finance Committee spent a lot of time on this yesterday, and this piece by piece, to make sure they're on top of this stuff, that these things just don't appear. We're still well within our budget, but we're still these people.
And contractors. The other thing, one of the aspects of a project is to. One of the metrics that you can utilize for a project that's going well is the change order volume or percentage versus the contract. Typical projects, 5-7%, 8% is a pretty good change order ratio. We're way down on the project. I mean, we're getting to the last months of work here, and we're still under 2%, so we're doing very well on a change order basis.
Any more discussion? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Approved. The second contract is the Telpro low voltage wiring and equipment contract. And you can see that on the same page 45, the second line item, $356. This came out to a additional percentage of 16.7% of the original approved amount. You can see this on page 51 through 53 as a summary of the amendment.
I'll move on border 8B3.
Any more discussion? All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Vote. Next item is office engineering. Request amendment, request of $83,273 to Pinal Valley Engineering. You can see the amendment on page 55 and 56 and 57. The summary of the amendment cost. Any more discussion on item 8B4? All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And the final item, which is item number 5, is interior design and construction management for an additional $6,525 to Rothman Interiors. And that amendment can be found on page 59 and 60.
Remember?
Page 59 and 60.
Is this chair?
No. It's interior design and building. Design and building.
Okay, I move on order 8B5.
Any more discussion? All in favor, indicate by saying aye. Opposed? Anything else, Pedro? That concludes my report.
I just will add for the rest of the board, I know that the finance committee discussed this a little bit yesterday, but the project's going along very, very well. It's a very complicated and difficult project. But it seems to be moving along, and we should have a new building to be able to go in and see and use my first
Are you making sure that
happens
so that we don't have these change orders
more time?
That's
right.
You
want to get
another tour of that? Sure. Item 18, general manager report. Link. Bring it up. Okay, here's the general manager's report for October 10th, 2017. The watershed forecast is for cool temperatures in the Feather River Basin, dry and warmer conditions in the next week. Statewide precipitation, we start a new water year October 1st. So we can close the book on 2016-2017 precipitation, 94.7 inches in the Feather River 8 zone, 190% average. That's phenomenal year. The first allocation for the new year will come December 1st. So here's a diagram. 10-day weather forecast. We look at these as a staff level just to see what's happening as far as the weather goes. You can see that there's no weather anticipated in the next 10 days. But we they got snow level over 12,000 feet, and that varies in here's the final graph. For the water year, you can see the green line at the top. The last year record for our aid station, which was in Orville, at 94.7. So, historic. It's a historic year. The Delta conditions, Orville's releasing 45,000
cubic feet per second at the present time. They're continuing to maintain a statistically low level of reserves in Oroville because of the spillway corrections. The total delta inflow is 12,870 cubic feet per second. There's no major changes in the pumping. It's pretty low right now. We maintain X2, which is the freshwater seawater interface, and we have to have it a certain amount of kilometers away from the bridge. And so the total delta outflow is 14,200 CFS. So when anybody says we're pumping the thing dry, well, actually, you've got 14,000 of the 22 coming in is actually going to the ocean as well. We can see how much water is actually going to the ocean. Here's our reservoir conditions. You can note here that on the right, you can see Oroville. Our historical average is considerably higher than where we're at the present time. All of the other reservoirs within California are well above average. And most importantly, San Luis, the lower section of the graph, is well above historic averages. I'll give you an idea of historic conditions. This is 2014, that was the year we had the real shortage of water, real short water year. You can see it was where Oroville Reservoir was. And, oops. You can see it's right here. And this was 2015. And you can see we're currently down here. So we're right in that drought type of condition. Whereas look at St. Louis, when we had a drought condition, we had very, very little water south of the Delta. Even this time last year, we had very little water south of the Delta. But you can see where we are this year. We have a lot of water south of the Delta. That lends itself pretty well for a good initial allocation because there's so much water south of the Delta. Here's the storage capacity. You can see how it's going to come down, and it just provides that further reference for us. This is kind of, this shaded area is kind of what the average would be. So, here's the, you remember just last year we were talking way down here as to what these levels are, and here we are this morning here. So, you know, just as quickly as it's here, you can go back to here. So we got to remember that. You know, it goes quick. We still have 85% of our table amount to 123,000 feet. We went through a preliminary review of performance this year, what we anticipate to have left over next year with our water supply. We're anticipating approximately 35,000 feet to be held over the San Luis Reservoir as of January 1. The balance of the water supply and the water that's being returned and what we're supposed to utilize in some fashion. We had over, even though we have take lay at 123, we had some other water, we had some carryover water, we had water that we got, which was on 21, so we were able to utilize almost 100%. I will say, too, let you know that we did receive the check from the Corps Exchange, $3.5 million, so that was kind of an average check. We went ahead and sent our delivery request to DWR for 2018, and we anticipate our first initial application December 1st. We still plan to be fairly full by the end of the year. We do run the risk if it's a wet cycle to lose some of that water, so we're going to continue to bank as much water as we can from now to the end of the year and early into next year to see if we can bring that down. Yes, yes. In other words, trying to utilize some of that. We have less chance of losing, you know, put it in our own bank as opposed to somewhere else. So that's what we're trying to do. But we may not be able to get it out fast enough if we have a really wet January. So we'll see how it goes. But we're doing everything we can possibly do. So.
No, it's interesting. I mean, you see everything. Lakes up there, hot water, power up in Eastern Sierras, we're all for. And, you know, we're all for Resolute Corp. I just don't understand why they couldn't get water in Lake Elizabeth. I mean, I know it's all political, it's all 100%. Just, there was more than plenty of water to fill that thing up. But it costs nickels and dimes, and it's just a sad situation. Because I look at that more than just a lake. I look at that as something the county supervisor enforced upon the water there for any kind of fire prevention. Like, you know what? You mentioned we have an Anaheim Hills situation in that area, and y'all gonna say, "Oh, shucks, we could put water in this lake, and they could use the drop helicopter to suck the water out." I mean, it's a perfect location for that, but yet nobody wants to do anything. It's sad.
So, here's our treatment plant recovery system. You can see we're currently at 40 million gallons a day on the till. Roseman's off, the Eastside plant, 1 million gallons a day. I want to say that I'm sure the Acton PWD exchange, I'm sure that's the exchange for the plant, just to be, you know, 1.8 million gallons there. And I know the Acton plant's not running, so. And then the Eastside water bank, 1.1 million gallons a day there, and then we have our public on this side to facilitate those customers. That's what we have.
As we look at,
sure.
Are you saying that Roseman hasn't taken a loan from us this year?
No, I'm not saying that. All I'm saying is that we haven't used the treatment plant. What we've used is the slip line to be able to utilize that, because by putting the water into the groundwater bank, removing that water through the slip, bringing it over to Roseman to serve those areas, or through our agricultural wells to serve those areas, it is less expensive than to run the plant, because we don't have the true cost of water. So we're utilizing it as a management strategy. We also get excellent water quality. So we're putting the water in, we're taking it out, but our treatment is being done naturally as opposed to Skagit well is off and hasn't been utilized during this wet year at all. We're still paying the rents. It's done at the end of this year. So we won't have any more lease payments for the first
year. The well's worthless because they did not reserve their water rights for that well. You know, I know that, just said that.
It's not in the file.
Unbelievable.
Okay, so it looks like we have the west side and the east side water banks. You can see the recharge amount for 85,580. 8 feet of west side and 1,580 feet on the east side. We have a combined total of water in storage over 100,000 feet right now. So we have at least 2 full years of customer demand in storage waiting for the next drought. Even if the catastrophe happens, we have zero coming from the Still Park project. By our normal customers for at least 2 years.
Our goal's been 3.
Our goal's been 3, so we're 2/3 then.
Yeah, no, it's really accomplishment. I mean,
yeah,
the
board
and the staff putting this whole thing together, it's never existed in this valley. And it was a catastrophe where, you know, Edmondson Plant was blown up with an earthquake or whatever. We still have that availability for that water.
Yeah, that's right. And so, you know, as we continue to move on through the next year, you know, there's a likelihood or opportunity that we may be able to add some more water and get closer to the 1,000-acre project.
But also, there's a behind the developer of the high desert.
That's right. I mean, that's...
That's, you know.
Are we still banking anything with the high desert project? We aren't banking anything, as you like to say. We are pilot testing the project over there.
Use the right word, spirit of the world.
I know.
Is that with the 15% that we have to leave?
That's with the West, the $100,000, $100,000. It's a lot more than that. That's what 100,000 acre feet is with the 10%. That's what's recoverable to source.
That's AVAX water, so we only have those 10.
Yeah.
And we're talking anybody else we bring their water in, we use our facility, we're going to have 15%.
So our water quality is still remains favorable. Bromide levels are down, so everything's looking good from that, in that aspect. We expect our THMs and all of our wells below 8% levels. So we're really getting water quality this year. Some status and updates is to our Little Rock Dam reservoir on Thursday to the 12:30 a.m.
Does
that start? It's done. We're going to go on the water and we're going to go from there. So we'll have some staff that will go on that tour and some workers. Also, we got the AWWA Calendar Data Conference October 23rd to 6th. And we're going to be the Water Master Board meeting on the 25th. 10 a.m. We have the AV, Antelope Valley State Water Contractor Association meeting October 26th, and it's this particular meeting is going to be on the AVAC. We also have Orville Spillway Phase 1 on November 1st, and then the Aqua Conference on November 28th through December 1st. I will be in the office in the morning. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Approved? All right. We are now adjourned to the Inquiry and Financial Authority. And we're considering item A, adoption of resolution number FAR-1703, authorizing the scrap amendment to the venture. Yes, this is a pretty good. The Finance Committee reviewed this. This is a procedural matter that the Bond Council has requested because the official statement that was presented that described the bonds that would be sold had a particular language to them, and the actual bonds were a little bit different, didn't change any of the terms to AVAC or anything like that. But in order to make our official statement consistent with the actual bonds that were sold, we're asking for this change to be made. And it's been reviewed by our bond council. It's a fairly common practice in this council. So this is for our clean energy renewable funds. And so staff would recommend to you.
Do we have a motion to adopt the resolution?
Resolution.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Approved. Now do I have a motion to reconvene to a regular meeting?
So moved. All right. Someone?
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. We've reconvened to the regular AVAC meeting. Item 9, Director's Report. Eric?
No.
Item 10, Attorney's Report. Now, item 11, do we have a reason to go into closed session today?
Just one more than we all have enough.
Actually, two.
Two items.
All right, do I have a motion to go into closed session? Which items,
No, that's it.
Do we have a motion to go into closed session for items 11, C, and E? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Go into closed session after 5 minutes.